The year 1346 was a proud year for the English. That year, King Edward III led his army in a successful landing on the northern coast of France. The Battle of Crecy, which followed soon afterwards, marked the beginning of the 100 years war between England and France. The English army at that time relied heavily on its longbows. But at the Battle of Crecy, they used a mysterious new weapon, capable of hurling solid 2-pound bombs over long distances. Although only three of them were used, they had a devastating impact on the French cavalry. This mysterious weapon was an early form of the cannon. The introduction of the cannon undoubtedly represented a major advance from bows and arrows. Yet, by the time of the Battle of Crecy, cannons were already in common use in the East. Beside Poyang Lake in China, at around the same time as the Battle of Crecy, a fierce battle was fought between the armies of Zhu Yuanzhang, who would later found the Ming Dynasty, and Chun Yualiang, self-proclaimed king of Greater Han. Both sides used cannons. In terms of their caliber, the cannons were quite similar to those used by the English. However, their use was far more widespread. Several thick, round barrels forged of iron stand beside the route leading to the battling section of the Great Wall. They are the oldest cannons in the world, called Huacheng. An investigation into the secrets of the Huacheng offer a priceless insight into the wisdom of China's ancient weapons manufacturers. The 5,000 years of Chinese civilization are revealed in part through the history of the country's weapons making. In China, bronze and iron smelting began several hundred years earlier than it did in the West. Accordingly, weapons making in China was also ahead of the rest of the world. The term Huacheng came to be used later in the Yuan and Ming dynasties to refer to a firearm with an all-metal barrel. It hurled out projectiles made of stone, lead, or iron. The invention of such firearms can be held up as a leap in the history of firearms manufacture. To know this great invention, we have to look back to an era of cold weapons. Cold weapons have long held a romantic appeal in China. This is evident from the fact that the characters in the wuxian, or martial fiction, tend to have magical skills in the use of their weapons. In Chinese martial arts, there is the notion of 18 weapons. But what precisely the 18 weapons are is a matter of some controversy. Generally, though, they are thought to include the bow, crossbow, spear, staff, saber, straight sword, lance, battle axe, halberd, mace, hammer, trident, and dagger axe. Some, such as the dagger axe, have fallen out of use. Some have changed, such as the battle axe, which is no longer the original large axe, but a more modern, smaller weapon consisting of a blade and a hook held in both hands. In fact, Chinese martial arts use many more weapons than those just mentioned. Taking into account the stranger weapons and those that have slipped into obscurity, the number would far exceed 100. In China, bronze and iron smelting began several hundred years earlier than it did in the West. The first weapons in China were made of bronze. Later, with the development of iron smelting, iron weapons appeared. By the time of the Western Zhao dynasty, some 3,000 years ago, China was the world leader in metalworking. By the late spring and autumn period, 2,500 years ago, the development of iron smelting techniques meant weapons were sharper and harder. This represented a major advance in weapons quality. Since iron ore was available in abundant quantities and iron was not only easier to forge than bronze, but also tougher, so iron became the main raw material for making huacheng. Iron was used to build the strong body of the huacheng, and cannonballs had to be fired by gunpowder. But how was gunpowder invented, after all? In the Tang Dynasty, over 1,400 years ago, weapons making received another boost, this time from an unlikely source. Alchemy, which gave birth to gunpowder, enjoys legendary status in Chinese history. It was a field of study that preoccupied not only Taoist priests, but also physicians, and among them, the famous Sun Simiao of the early Tang Dynasty. Sun Simiao, in his great work, Essential Instruments from the Scripture of the Elixirs of Great Clarity, mentions something called inner lurking sulfur. He explained that two liang of sulfur and two liang of niter should be ground together into a powder and put into a pot. The pot should be buried in a cave. When this is done, three burning Chinese honey locust seeds should be added to the pot so that the sulfur and niter start to burn. When the fire goes out, three jin of charcoal should be stirred into the remaining mixture. When around a third of the charcoal is burned up, the mixture should be removed before it cools. This is what Sun Simiao called lurking fire. Equal quantities of sulfur and niter ground into a powder can function somewhat like gunpowder when ignited. But it isn't gunpowder in the true sense until the right proportion of charcoal is added. Precisely what the right proportion was finally determined through repeated experiments. Assessing how explosive the mixture was indicated what were the right proportions of niter, sulfur, and charcoal to make gunpowder. Gunpowder was first put to military use in the late Tang Dynasty. At first, however, gunpowder proved relatively ineffective in battle because it was simply used as a burning material to hurl at the enemy. It wasn't until the reign of Tang Emperor Ai, from 904 to 907, that fire arrows and cannons were used in warfare. Later, in the 10th century, at the time of the Five Dynasties, other firearms, such as fireballs and fire caltrops, appeared. By the time of the Song Dynasty, gunpowder was used in many more weapons. This was made possible by improvements in gunpowder quality. It was under the Song Dynasty that a new weapon, called the Tuhpaoqiang, appeared. It was formed of three parts. To fire the weapon, the stock would be planted in the ground. The bamboo barrel would be held steady by the left hand, and it would be ignited with the right hand. With a deafening roar, a rock or some other projectile would be sent flying out of the barrel, while the remaining gunpowder still burning would be flung 2 or 3 meters ahead. The weapon was more of a psychological threat than an effective weapon, though, but its unique structure was the basis of the future Huaqiong. The Military Museum of the Chinese People's Revolution houses a Yuan Dynasty Huaqiong that was forged in 1332. It is thick, 35.3 centimeters in length, and weighs 6.94 kilos. It has a 10.5 centimeter caliber at the mouth and 7.7 centimeter caliber at the stock. It is believed to be the oldest surviving Huaqiong in the world. The Huaqiong consisted of three parts: barrel, gunpowder chamber, and stock. Various types of Huaqiong were developed, from the hand cannons used by individual soldiers to the bowl Huaqiongs and calyx Huaqiongs used by navies and in the defense of cities. The portable hand cannons had long, thin barrels and chambers that bulged like balls for the gunpowder, which would be ignited through a touch hole.